नमामि धन्वंतरि मादिदेवं सुरासुरैर्वन्दित पादपद्मं लोकैर्जरारुभय मृत्युनाशं धातारमीशं विविधौषधीनां।
नमस्कार। तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः। On behalf of Charak Sanhita Research, Training and Skill Development Center, a MOU partner, IPGTRA Gujarat Ayurved University, Jamnagar, I welcome you all in the day of the talk series, expert talk series on concept of health. Today, we have two eminent speakers, Professor H.M. Chandola and Professor B.S. Prasad. Professor H.M. Chandola will talk on utility of preventive health checkups, current scenario, and Professor B.S. Prasad will talk on current approach towards health in society. It's my privilege to introduce Professor Dr. H.M. Chandola. He has been the professor and hospital director, Uttaranchal Ayurvedic College and Hospital, Dehradun, Uttarakhand. He was the formerly director of and principal Brahma Prakash Ayurved Charak Samsthan, Delhi. He has designated the head of the department Kaya Chikitsa and Dean IPGTRA Gujarat Ayurved University, Jamnagar. He has done MD and PhD in Ayurved with 40 years of clinical and teaching experience. He has been the chairman of Institutional Ethics Committee, MP Shah Medical College, Jamnagar. He was the coordinator of WHO Collaborating Center, IPGTRA, Jamnagar. He has been instrumental to uplift the quality of publication in Ayurved field. He has been the executive editor of AYU, an international peer-reviewed journal of Ayurved. He is an excellent author, eloquent orator, editor, reviewer, mentor, guide, philosopher for all the Ayurved community in India and abroad. He has played instrumental role in the initiation of Charak Sanhita New Edition project with Dr. Gopal Vasisht. He has published 136 research papers, 11 chapters to his credit, and delivered 46 guest lectures and radio talks. I welcome you, sir. I request you to present your views and share your thoughts on the topic. Thank you.
Thankful to the patron, Dr. Gopal Vasisht ji, to give me an opportunity to have a free interaction with the young participants who very effectively participated in essay competition, which was recently organized. The topic given is utility of preventive health checkup in the current scenario. So first of all, we have to understand what is the actually health, and then how the preservation and promotion of health, this objective can be achieved, and how an awareness can be developed to have the proper health checkup from preventive and promotive point of view. As you all know, health is not merely an absence of disease. Rather, it covers the physical, mental, social, spiritual, and emotional component of the health, as recommended by WHO under different dimensions. The Ayurvedic view about the health, the most accepted view is advocated by Sushruta, where Sushruta says that that person is healthy whose doshas are in the balanced state. Now these doshas are the basically three psychodimensional entities. You all know, friends, the cosmic air, is represented as vata in our body. The cosmic sun is represented as a pitta, and cosmic moon is pinda, tata, brahmande. So all these three cosmic forces are governing our human physiological system. So these doshas, the agni, the digestive fire, and all the excretory functions should be in a balanced state. This denotes the physical component of the health. And then in the second component, Sushruta has discussed the present state of the senses, the mental health, and the spiritual dimension of the health. You know, at present, we are hardly aware about 6 to 10% function of the human brain. Rest 90% part of the brain is in dormant phase. And here the role of yoga comes. So when we talk about the prasannatmendriya mana, the mental and spiritual health, how it could be achieved? It could be achieved through the path of yoga. In that way, yoga is an integral part of Ayurveda. Yoga is not a separate entity. You will find lot of references of yoga in Shariristhan and at other places also. So this is the Sushruta's view of the health when he talks about the physical, mental, and spiritual well-being. Charak also has discussed health in same way. Especially, you will find the reference in the Sutrasthan 21st chapter, when he is talking about the proportionate musculature, then compactness of the body, sensory and motor functions of the senses, and also about the proper hunger, thirst, tolerance for heat and cold, and also about the digestion and metabolism. So these are the components which are discussed by Charaka under the concept of health. So this also covers the physical, mental, and sensorial health part by Charaka. So there is not much difference. Kashyap also discussed health, and according to Kashyap, he has also discussed different component about the urge for food and its digestion, then elimination of platelets, urine, stool, also about the present state of senses, the vitality, and agni part. So these are also discussed about the by Kashyap about the physical, mental, and spiritual health. So in that way, you will find almost similarity about Charak, Sushruta, and Kashyap regarding the health. You cannot make watertight compartment between body and mind. The whole approach of Ayurveda is a psychosomatic. What is happening in the mind that affect the somatic part, and what is happening in the body that ultimately affect the psychic part. So the total approach of Ayurveda is psychosomatic. The concept of life is also, life is nothing but the sum total of body, mind, and soul. So it is a integral integration between body, mind, and spirit. That is the concept of Ayu or life in Ayurveda. Lot of emphasis is given about the Pragyaparat. When, because of the derangement in the intellect and memory, that leads towards Pragyaparat, the person is not able to take proper decision. And because of that, psychosomatic disturbance, this invites the disease condition. So psychosomatic dimension is very important so far as the disturbance in the health is concerned. There are various causes. If you are able to identify the cause for the disturbance of health, you can certainly take care of those disturbing causes to achieve the preservation of health and prevention of disease. Everyone has this kaam, krodh, lobh, moh, etc. Lust, fear, grief, envy, anger, worry, guilt, frustration, depression, mental fatigue. These are described as a manasik bhav. And these, when these are in physiological range, these are manasik bhav. When they go beyond physiology, same manasik bhav are termed as manasik vikar. So these are nothing but the various kind of emotions. So mental and physical stress also emphasize as a dharma, unrighteous act in Vimanisthan by Charak in the third chapter. So these psychic traits should always be given due importance so far as the cause of the disease is concerned. Again, they have mentioned the various kind of emotions like harsh or happiness. It has a vrangan effect, nourishment of the body. And vishad, dukkha or unhappiness is an aggravating factor for disease condition. Shok or grief, sorrow that causes emaciation. This Charak has discussed in Sutra Sthan 25th chapter in detail. So you will find the beautiful concept of psychoneuroimmunology in Ayurvedic literature. How the various kind of emotional states have a lot of direct impact on our physiological system. I remember in the year 1987, when the then Vice Chancellor Mr. V.R. Mehta in Gujarat Ayurveda University wanted to start some yoga-related academic activities, and various experts were invited. And one of the experts was Professor T. Deshiraju, who was Professor of Physiology at National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences, Bangalore. Unfortunately, Dr. T. Deshiraju died few years back because of myocardial infarction. So at that time, this I am telling you the story of 1987 when T. Deshiraju came to Jamnagar, and he very elaborately discussed this psychoneuroimmunology part. And at that time, he told that this is the development of last 5 years. I'm telling you 1987. So that means he was talking about the 1980 era, how this under life sciences, this psychoneuroimmunology came into existence. When we are under stress, the blood sample were collected and there was lowering of the immunoglobulin. So under stress, our immune system is lowered and we are susceptible for disease condition. When you are in deep meditation, again blood sample were collected and it was seen that the immunoglobulin level goes up. So meditation improves our immune system and stress lowers our immune system, making our body susceptible for disease condition. When there is a thought of anger, different part of brain has shown circulatory changes. When there is a thought of anger, when there is a thought of grief, sorrow, when there is a thought of pleasure, the different part of the brain has shown changes. And scientists have recorded these changes. In that way, different kind of emotion altered our blood biochemistry. So this part is covered under psychoneuroimmunology. And this description of Charak, how the happiness has a nourishment effect, how vishad or unhappiness leads to the aggravating factor for disease, and how grief or sorrow causes emaciation. So far as this mental health is concerned, we should take care of our all these manasik bhav. few years back on WhatsApp, a video clip was circulated of Dr. B.M. Hegde, and he was discussing about autoimmune disorder. And when he was telling that the exact cause is not known, but he said that these negative emotions like kama, krodh, lobh, moh, these negative emotions work as a triggering factor for such a autoimmune disorder. So we should not take lightly the disturbance in these emotional bhavas or manasik bhavas. Again, in Vimanisthan, Charak has mentioned that even a food which is taken in a proper proportion, which is a pathya, but if it is taken under the influence of worry, grief, fear, and anger, the digestion is not proper. It is not properly metabolized. And that means all these mental factors like worry, grief, fear, anger, that adversely affect our agni or the ultimately the digestion and metabolism is impaired. So ultimately this leads towards formation of aam, because aam is the triggering factor of all disease condition. So this mental part should not be neglected. But many people are exposed to such adverse situation, but every person is not affected. So here the role of your personality, the person who are more introvert in nature, they are more likely to suffer with such a stress induced disorders. The person who are more of extrovert in nature, we say na antarmukhi vyaktitva and bahirmukhi vyaktitva. So introvert people are more likely to suffer with the psychosomatic disturbance, and extrovert people are, they have less susceptibility because they are not keeping anything inside. Introvert people, they are not getting an emotional outlet. That's why there is an accumulation of emotion inside, and that makes a person more susceptible for these disturbances. And this stressor may be acute, this stressor may be chronic. So acute and chronic stress also play a very role. So personality of a person, whether he is introvert or extrovert, or nature of stress, whether it is acute in nature or it is chronic in nature, that also have an impact on the occurrence of disease. That's why a care is to be taken so far as this preventive health care is concerned, that identify the stress, identify the personality of a person, and recently what happened, you have seen in the Bollywood, one film artist, Sushant Singh Rajput, he committed suicide. So a person who is more introvert, a person who is not interacting with his environment, he may commit such type of act. And if there is some family history for such ailments, then such act are frequently can be seen. Again, when we talk about the preventive approach, there are various things are said. Holding up of emotions, the dharaniya veg, adharaniya veg, grief, greed, anger, jealousy, vanity, shamelessness, excessive attachment. We should have a control on these emotions, holding up, control on these manasik bhav. We should advise the person to follow proper code of conduct which are described in the Ayurvedic literature under the heading of Achar Rasayana. We should follow the moral values, general ethics, respect for our teachers, respect for our family members, for our elders, and we should not have an eye on the property of others. So these are the ethical values. One should follow these values: truthfulness, pleasing in speech, devoid of alcohol, sex indulgence, practice of mantra jap. Mantra jap is very important thing. Every person can have his own mantra depending upon his faith. Honorable Dr. Gopal Vashish ji is sitting here. He's a very good friend, Dr. Hari Sharma, who had been head of integrative medicine in Ohio Medical School. He has done lot of work on this mantra jap. He has seen how this mantra jap has an effect on growth of cancer. They developed cancer in animals, and when such animals were given exposure of hard and fast music, the growth of the cancer cell was rapid. In another group, when exposure of Hanuman Chalisa, Hari Om Sharan Hanuman Chalisa was given, there was a reduction in the growth of cancer cell. So in 2-3 group, they have compared how the mantra jap, mantra exposure have an effect on the growth of cancer cell. So in that way, this mantra jap has a scientific effect. Cleanliness in thought, word and deed, all these have a positive effect on our positive health. Now, you know, in Ayurveda they have discussed about the therapeutic diagnostic procedure, upshayatmak chikitsa. Suppose a person is getting fever and he is given any quinine preparation and fever is relieved, that means the person was suffering with malaria. In that way, if we are getting some symptoms related to any specific organ, and if that organ is specific rejuvenative drug, organ specific rasayana is given, and if a person gets relief, we can say that this person has or had that organ related some ailment. So lot of work has been done on this part about organ specific rasayana, which is very important not only for preservation and promotion of health, rather also effective in prevention and cure of disease as well. There is a concept in Ayurveda, Purve Vaisi Madhyava. If someone has a history for a disease in his family, for a particular disease, so to take care of that disease, that it should not occur in the progeny, if we administer that organ specific rasayana in very beginning, the occurrence of that disease can be avoided. And if in any disease condition that drug is given, it has a curative effect as well. So what I am putting before you, these things, these are based on extensive researches done on various herbs for the health of the brain. Lot of work has been done for taking care of brain or health of the brain or diseases related to the nervous system. The role of, you know, Brahmi, Bacopa monieri, it is a very good memory enhancer. And any drug which you want to give for health of the brain, if it is given with the ghee as a drug vehicle, maximum part of the drug molecule is able to cross blood-brain barrier. That is the reason you will find maximum formulation in Ayurvedic literature are ghee-based. If it is given in the powder form, then less part of the drug is able to cross the blood-brain barrier. But same drug given with the ghee or oil as a drug vehicle, that cross the blood-brain barrier effectively 50 to 60%, and it hits the target organ, brain. And when we were working on dementia, we have seen when this Brahmi Grath was given to the rats, and after that, when blood sample were collected, we were able to see that the becocyte, which was the active, drug molecule, that was measured in the blood. That means after ghrit kalpana, when it is prepared with ghee, the active drug molecule is not destroyed when it is boiled with the ghee to prepare the Brahmi ghrit. So Bacopa monnieri is a very good drug so far as memory is concerned. So it is a drug of choice for health of the brain, for forgetfulness, or Alzheimer, for senile dementia. Similarly, Acorus calamus, that is Vacha. Then Tenospora cordifolia, Guduchi or Giloy. Nowadays, everyone is talking in light of this corona crisis that to take care of the immunity, Giloy is the drug of choice. When in Samudra Manthan, when Lord Dhanvantari appeared, so among the four things, one was this Giloy plant in his hand. Similarly, this Jyotishmati, lot of work has been done on this Celestris paniculatus on depression. Dr. Tanuja Nesri, who is heading the All India Institute of Ayurveda at Delhi as a director, she has done lot of work on this Celestris paniculatus. Shankhpushpi, convolvulus pluricollis, and Centella asiatica, Mandukoparani, are also the drug which have shown proven action clinically and experimentally for brain. Then this heart also a very vital organ. The drugs like Terminalia arjuna bark of this arjun is used, and Inula racemosa, the Pushkar mool, now it is an endangered plant. So it has also shown very good result on isoprenaline induced model of myocardial infarction. When this alcoholic extract of Inula racemosa was given, it has changed the whole pattern of MI. So Inula racemosa and Terminalia arjuna on experimental model of myocardial infarction by this isoprenaline, that has shown the effect on this necrosed heart tissue. In chronic cases, this because this deposition of lipid also causes this myocardial ischemia. So this Commiphora whitei, Guglu, old name was Commiphora mucul. So Guglu is a resin of a plant, and its granules are after purifying with cow's milk and or Trifla quark, that is used. And as a substitute of Inula racemosa, nowadays Sasuriya lappa, the Kushth, that also has shown hypolipidemic action. So these are the drugs which take care of the health of the heart. So as an organ specific rasayana, these herbs can be of a great benefit. For respiratory tract, the drugs like haldi, curcuma longa, vasa, adotoda vesica, and glycyrrhiza glabra, lycoris, muleti, and this shirish, albizia lebec. Albizia lebec is a tree, and in Ayurvedic literature, they have mentioned shirish patra, the leaves of this. But the scientific work which has been done, that is on bark of this albizia lebec, and it has shown antihistaminic activity, and also it induces the endogenous cortisol. So sometimes we give a combination of shirish, vasa, kantakari, and muleti as a decoction, and various pharmacies have prepared the granules of this decoction. So you all know haldi has shown very good antihistaminic activity. Haldi is also recommended for Alzheimer. So for the health of the respiratory tract, these are the herbs of choice, particularly for the allergy related problem like asthma, allergic rhinitis, sinusitis, so, and chronic rhinitis. So these drugs works miraculously. For the health of the stomach, this amalki, Amelica officinalis, the quantity which we find in 1 dozen oranges, the quantity of vitamin C available in 1 dozen oranges is equal to same quantities found in one single amla fruit. So amla is the richest source of vitamin C. Lot of work has been done, and it has a very, healing effect on gastric ulcer. It takes care of the mucous membrane of the stomach. Similarly, bhrangraj, eclipta, elba, and this is shatavari, asparagus, racemosus. Very good drug for taking care of the ulcer, whether it is gastric ulcer or duodenal ulcer, but amalki especially for this gastric ulcer. For the health of the liver, Philanthus amarus or Philanthus niruri, both are used as a bhumi amalki, and it has shown good results in hepatitis A, hepatitis B, and hepatitis C as well. And this Kalame andrographic paniculata, this Professor Green Singh Tomar, who had been Dean of the Ayurvedic Faculty in Kanpur University and Principal at Government Ayurvedic College in Allahabad, he has done lot of work on this Kalmeh. And pipli, everyone know, Piper Longum, very good bio enhancer and very good drug for the health of the liver. Picroriza curva, Kutki, lot of work has been done in Banaras University by Professor Gorakhnath Chaturvedi, Dr. Vivekanand Pandey, who had been director of the CCRAS, and Jamnagar based Professor Padma Shri, Professor Gurdeep Singh Ji. He has also done lot of work and published monograph also on Kutki, Picroriza curva in the liver disorder. So for the health of the preventive point of view, also for the health of the liver, these drugs, these herbs can be taken without any problem. Pancreas is a very important organ. Nowadays everyone talk about diabetes. So for the health of the pancreas, the Vijasa, Pterocarpus marsupium, also known as Bijak, and Vijasa, Bijak, these are the synonym of this Pterocarpus marsupium. Asan also it's a synonym. And jamun, you know, nowadays jamun fruit can be seen in the market, CGM cumini. Karela, Mamordica cherentia, and tejpatra, cinnamomum tamal, which is used in every kitchen with the rice pulao, and Swartia cerata, that is cerata. Lot of work has been done by Dr. S.K. Mukherjee in CDRI Lucknow, and he has identified different alkaloids in Swartia cerata. Some of them are insulin promoter. Some of them, they do not act through insulin, but they potentiate the hypoglycemic action of from different mode of action. And this cinnamomum tamal, we have seen a particular alkaloid is reducing the blood sugar through stimulating the beta cell. It promotes the release of insulin. And Japanese has mentioned that the main alkaloid in Karela is in the seed. Sometime after vegetable, everyone throws the seed. It should not be thrown away. It should be eaten. The main active principle is in the Karela seed. In Indian tradition, the whole Karela is crushed and its juice is taken. I would like to refer the work done by Professor H.P.T. Aman, who was director of the Institute of Pharmacology in Tübingen. At that time, it was two separate country, East Germany, West Germany. Now, both the part are unified. So he was in the western part of Germany. What he did, he isolated the beta cell of a guinea pig, and then he put total alcoholic extract of Vijasar. Huge release of insulin was observed. And when he presented his observation in the Institute of Medical Sciences of Banaras Hindu University, three doctors of the Institute of Medical Sciences, one from pharmacology, one from histopathology, and one from medicine, Dr. Bhattacharji, Dr. Gambhir, and Dr. Saroj Gupta, what they did? They produced alexion-induced diabetes in rats. And then those rats were given alcoholic extract of Pterocarpus marsupium. Not only blood sugar came down, they sacrifice the rats and then they observe regenerative pattern in the beta cell. So long-term administration of VJSR may also help in the regeneration of beta cell in the human being also. There was a published paper of Madras Medical College and they reported that Pterococcus marsupium could be a future drug for juvenile diabetes. They produced diabetes in dogs. And in dogs, after producing diabetes, they have given this alcoholic extract of VJSR. And then they established how it works in the Alexon model. So VJSR, the active principle is epicatechin, which is very less in quantity. So VJSR is used in good quantity, say 20 gram, 30 gram, and then prepare decoction. And then this decoction is given before meal, at least twice a day, before breakfast or dinner, or before lunch or dinner. So this decoction helps a lot in this diabetic conditions. So if there is a family history of diabetes in the family, so from preventive point of view also, as a preventive measure, person can take at least once a day VJSR decoction, no problem. So these are the, similarly, Karela and this Tejpath. Even Dalchini also has shown very good results, Zelenicum. For the health of intestine, some of the patient you may find of diarrhea, colitis, some of the patient you may find of constipation. So depending upon that, Haritki, Terminalia cibula for constipation, it is a very good herb. And for diarrhea, for dysentery, for colitis, Kutaj, Hollerina anti-dysentrica, and Bale, Eagle marmalose, it's a majja, it's a marrow is used. So these are very good drug for the health of intestine. So without any problem, for the health of the intestine, it can be taken. For the urinary tract, the drug of choice is Punarnava, Boravia diffusa. The name itself, Punarnava, which repeatedly, Punar means repeatedly, Nava means new, regeneration. Monograph is published by Alan Singh and R.S. Singh on kidney and its regeneration. It is on Punarnava. And this Punarnavashtak Kwat, Punarnavadi Kadha are the drug of choice for such problem. Even the patient who are on dialysis, if Punarnava is given, the period between two dialysis is increased. So it is a very good drug for health of the kidney. Lot of work has been done in various institutions, including CDRI Lucknow, on Varun, Creativia Nurvala for stone, and Gokharu, Tubulus terrestris. It is also a very good drug for urinary tract, for your kind information. Chinese scientists have identified one saponin in Gokharu, which is coronary dilator. So even for ischemic heart patient, where you are giving Arjun Pushkarmool, you can also add Gokharu because of a saponin present in it, which is a coronary dilator. So in that way, in reference to this urinary tract, Punarnava, Gokharu and Varun are the drug of choice. For genital system, especially for the female health, this Japa Kusum, that red flower which is offered to goddess. So a lot of work has been done and it has also shown anti-fertility action. So for a family welfare program, for this hibiscus rosa, Japa Kusum is recommended. Ashoka, Sereka Ashoka, its bark is used, and Shatavari also, Asparagus racemosus, which contain a number of phytoestrogen. So these are the drug for the care of the genital system. And for male genital system, the मिक्यूना प्रोरेंस और कपिकच्छु कौचा एंड अश्वगंधा विदेनिया सोमनीफेरा, दीज आर हाईली रिकमेंडेड स्पेशली फॉर दोज पेशेंट हु हैव सम सेक्सुअल हेल्थ डिस्टर्बेंस मेनली ड्यू टू डिप्रेशन. देयर मिक्यूना प्रोरेंस कौचा इज रिकमेंडेड. एंड फॉर दोज पेशेंट हु हैव साइकोसेक्सुअल प्रॉब्लम mainly due to anxiety, for those patients ashwagandha vidhenya somnifera is recommended because ashwagandha has shown very good anti-anxiety and anti-stress effect, and this kapikachhu mucuna prurins has shown anti-depressant action, and because of the presence of L-dopa in the seed, it is also recommended for Parkinson's disease. And two type of seeds, black seed and white seed, but both are used and both seeds contain this L-dopa, natural L-dopa in it. So in that way, organ specific rasayana can be effectively used for preventive health program, for preservation and promotion of health. In the condition when disease occurrence has also taken place, there also as a curative purpose also these herbs can be used. When we talk about Vakti Tenka, lot of description is available in the Ayurvedic literature. We cannot keep our eyes closed for the recent advances taking place here and there. Lot of work has been done for better understanding of Tridosh Vakti Tenka on scientific line, in terms of biological rhythm and in terms of neurohumors. As Ayurveda says, yes, yat pinde tat brahmande, what is happening in the cosmos that has a direct impact on our body. So in that way, Ayurvedic physiology is well integrated with the cosmic physiology, life rhythm. Our literature says that in early childhood kapha is predominantly high. During younger age, pitta gets high. During old age, vata gets high. So this is nothing but the life rhythm. All the psychobiological dimensions, which are predominantly high in early childhood, can be covered under the broad umbrella of kapha or shleshma. All the psychobiological entities, which are predominantly high during younger age, can be categorized under pitta. And all the psychobiological entities which are predominantly high during old age can be categorized under vata. So the relationship between dosh in terms of age, diet, and then morning, noon, evening, circadian rhythm, seasonal conditions, six seasons, are told, Varsha, Sharad, Heman, Shishir, Vasanta, Grishma, in those seasons, accumulation, vishesha, and natural subsidence is discussed. So these are the seasonal rhythm. And then when sun is northward and when sun is southward, the kaf and vat are discussed as per the situation of sun under solar rhythm. So we can understand what with kaf in terms of these biological rhythm. Also, a lot of work has been done when they have tried to make a correlation that vatic activity can be represented by the high level of acetylcholine. And in Pittaj Prakriti people, they have seen how the catecholamine, the epinephrine and norepinephrine level is high. And in Kafaj Prakriti people, the histamine is high. Similarly, their metabolizing enzyme cholinesterase and monoamine oxidase and histaminase are also high along with these neurotransmitters depending upon the prakriti of a person. They have also made a correlation with age. In childhood age, more histamine. In younger age, more catecholamine. In old age, more of acetylcholine. So based on age and based on prakriti, they have made a direct correlation for better understanding. I am not saying at all, I should not be misunderstood. I am not saying that what is acetylcholine. No, not at all. What I am saying is that acetylcholine can be covered under the broad heading of what? Catecholamine can be covered under the broad heading of pit. And histamine can be covered under the broad heading of cough or shleshma. It can be taken as an indicator, as an index for these doshic activity. Similarly, all other hormone, neurotransmitters, other biochemical products can be classified under the umbrella of vat, pit and cough by doing work scientifically on healthy individuals, as has been done on these neurotransmitters. They have done on healthy state, they have also done in disease state. Acetylcholine is found high in anxiety state. Catecholamine is found high in hypertension, and histamine is found high in bronchial asthma, where you will find respectively predominancy of vat in anxiety, hypertension, pitta, and histamine in cough disorder, asthma, tamak shwas. Already you have seen this, you know, how in the seasons like rainy season, there is a vishesan of vat. In autumn, there is a vishesan of pitta. And in spring season, there is a vishesan of cough that make a person susceptible for these dosh related diseases in these seasons. So for preventive health point of view, if we are able to eliminate these accumulated vitiated doshas in these seasons, we can make person less susceptible for that dosh related disorder in that particular season. So it has a very important thing that that is why, you know, Vasantik Vaman is done. In spring season, they go for mass emesis to avoid the kaphas disorders. So in that way, these seasons and doshas accumulation vishesan, that cycle should be understood in a better way, so that susceptibility for those dosha related disorder can be lessened by elimination of those doshas. So this is very important about the doshic disturbance in these six seasons. Sushrut has discussed the Charak and Vagbhat's concept of Chaya Prakop Prasham in six stages, the Shad Kriya Kal, Sanchaya Prakop Prasar, and Sthan Sanchaya Vyakti and Bhed. And with the Sthan Sanchaya Avastha, the prodromal symptoms are seen in that particular stage, and the Vyakta Avastha is a clear cut symptomatology is there, and then in Bhed Avastha, the complication or this may work as a precipitating factor for other diseases. So in detail, Sushrut has discussed all the dietary factors, all the lifestyle related factors responsible for accumulation and vitiation of doshas, which then they spread throughout the body and then get localized at the point where organ weakness is there. And by localizing at that point where organ weakness is there, the disease manifestation takes place. The best physician is that who is able to identify the dosha in the very beginning stage, when doshas are in the stage of accumulation or vitiation. If you are able to identify those features which are described by Sushruta in the beginning, further progression of disease can be arrested by recommending proper diet and proper lifestyle, and wherever found necessary, proper therapeutic regime also. So this is Shat concept of Shat Kriya Kal, the sixth stage evolutive process for the development of disease. Its application is very important for preventive health checkup. it is of a great utility. So understanding and application of this sixth stage evolutive process for the development of disease, it should be applied in the patient. The features should be identified, should be recognized in the very beginning, so that disease can be arrested for further development. All these dietary factors and lifestyle factors are described by Sushruta here. I will give you example of 2-3 clinical conditions, how these for preventive health checkup point of view. Obesity is a very common problem, which is described as Mrdo Rog or Sthalya in Ayurvedic literature. And here, the prakriti is very important. A person is of kafaj prakriti, and if he is taking more fat-rich diet, less, work, more sedentary lifestyle, more kafaj diet, and he may be affected at very early by this problem of lipid disorder. If it is this lipid material is deposited in the arteries, it leads to atherosclerosis. If it is deposited in the heart, then ischemic heart disease. In the brain, it may lead to stroke. If accumulated in the basti, the premeha, the diabetic syndrome, and similarly other conditions can be precipitated. These are the risk factor when you are taking more nourished diet, rich in fat, and lack of exercise. There is an imbalance between intake and expenditure of the energy, which may lead to various lipid disorders. And to understand it, the body mass index is very important. If it is between 23 and 25, it is of mild type. 25 and 30, medium. And above 30, it is of severe obesity. So Ayurveda has discussed this Pramana Pariksha measurement, and now we can go for all these, we go for skin fold thickness by vernier caliper, waist circumference, hip circumference. So these are the objective parameters nowadays. You, as I mentioned, that you cannot keep your eyes closed for the recent advances, and the ultimate objective is to make a person healthy. So Ayurvedic parameters needs to be nourished, to be enriched by the latest scientifically evidence-based parameters at physical level, at biochemical level, at hormonal level, at radiological level also. So in Ayurvedic literature, they have mentioned various terminology, Medas Avrit Marg, Avadh Med, Badh Med. We can go for evaluation by lipid profile, free fatty acids, etc. And hyperinsulinemia, which denotes the, in obesity, you find hyperinsulinemia. In pre-diabetic condition, you find hyperinsulinemia. So these are objective parameters. And then when there is a Medo Dhatu Agni Mandya, we can go for apolipoprotein B evaluation, thyroid function test can be done. So these are objective parameters biochemically, which are available, can be adopted. In diabetic conditions also, you will find the genetic history is very important. Then lifestyle is very important because of the sedentary lifestyle, more carbohydrate and fat-rich diet, the type 2 diabetes is precipitated. 20 type of diabetic syndrome are discussed in various Ayurvedic literature, whether Charak, Sushruta, or Vagbhata. So these are at physical level, at symptom level, at the time the features were described in Mutre Abhidhavanti Pipilikash, the swarming of the ants in the urine. That shows the concept of glycosuria was there. Today we will go for urine sugar. Today we will go for blood sugar, for insulin value in the blood, whether it is in the beginning hyperinsulinemia, later on with advancing the disease, patient may lead to hypo or a insulinemia. So likewise, all these objective parameter are to be adopted. Many times patient comes to us and he is having overweight and no symptom. So that full blown disease is not developed. You can go for plasma insulin evaluation and then you can tell why. Sushruta says 100 yojan, 1 yojan is equal to 8 mile. So that shows how much your vyayam or brisk walking was recommended at that time. So that glucose uptake is there, glucose is utilized in the energy metabolism. Karpadada, burning hand and feet syndrome. Today you can go for nerve conductivity study. So for preventive health checkup point of view, all these are to be given due importance. Then a lot of description is available in Ayurvedic literature about urine examination, physical level, physical color is there. Then different colors are described of the urine. In 6 subtypes of Pittaj Prameha, sometimes black urine, sometimes urine is red in color, sometimes it is color is just like Manjistha decoction, sometimes. So there may be passing of indican, passing of hemoglobin, passing of red blood, and sometimes even the bile pigment. So they have mentioned the Haridrame. So when a diabetic patient is passing such type of colors in the urine. So these 20 subtypes are nothing but the different clinico-pathological presentation in the same disease depending upon interaction between 10 dushyas and 3 doshas. That's why the importance of dosha and dushya is given due importance in Ayurvedic literature. So these are the 20 subtypes, where 10 subtypes for Kaphaj Prameha, 6 for Pittaj Prameha and 4 for Vataj Prameha are described. So we can go for all the available objective tests at physical level, at microscopic level in the urine. One more condition I will discuss here, the Asthi Kshay or osteopenia and osteoporosis. You know, the normal bone and osteoporotic bone, when the pores are there and structural changes are already seen in the bony part, young and old people. So today we have different parameters about calcium, alkaline phosphatase, bone specific alkaline phosphatase, osteocalcin, and then there are bone marker, resorption marker, hydroxyproline, pyridinoline, etc. Other radiological assessment by X-ray, DEXA, ultrasound, MRI. You can go for BMD. So these are the features described in Ayurvedic literature about Asthi Kshay or osteopenia and osteoporosis, the bony pain, the fall of the hairs, fatigue, and deformity in the teeth and teeth fall, and deformity in the nails, and joint looseness, dryness. These are the Ayurvedic features they have described. And today we can go for serum calcium, alkaline phosphatase, EXA, BMD. So BMD up to -1 is normal. Between -1 and -2.5, it is osteopenia. And T score beyond -2.5 is osteoporosis. So we have to go for these available evidence-based tests for the health of the bone. And then we can recommend what diet is to be taken, what lifestyle to be taken, what herbs are to be taken for the health of the bone. lot of description is available in the Ayurvedic literature under a 10-fold examination, which is described as Dashvid Pariksha, about the essence of our dhatus, about prakriti, about vikriti, about compactness, about praman, measurement, and sar, essence, and compactness, samhanan. So today we will go, we will see if the person is not having all the sign and symptom described under dhatu sarta, so he has deficiency for those, particularly for rasa dhatu or rakta dhatu, mans, muscle tissue, or etc. Similarly, we can go for BMI, whether person is normal or it is going towards overweight or leading to obesity. So Ayurvedic features need support by the scientifically available parameter, pathological parameter. Sattva Pariksha is very important when we talk about the mental health. Every person has different temperament, so that is to be taken into consideration. His ahar shakti, his urge for food, his digestion capacity, metabolism capacity. So depending upon his ahar shakti, we will recommend him what type of food he should take. Then vyayam shakti, we can today go for TMT. Same vyayam exercise is not tolerable to that person who is having ischemic problem. So treadmill test can be done, normal blood pressure, ECG. So wherever found necessary, we have to go for preventive health checkup for cardiovascular health. We have to evaluate stress. Nowadays, lot of standardized questionnaire are available to evaluate anxiety, stress, neurotic symptom, etc. And then we can advise to the patient that you have to go for yoga, meditation, pranayama, so that stress-induced problem can be avoided. We can recommend him medhya drugs, ashwagandha, shankpushpi, brahmi type of drug, mental health promoting drug, so that he can keep away anxiety, stress, and its related disorders like insomnia, like ulcerative colitis, like irritable bowel syndrome, which all these conditions have a psychosomatic background. Viruddha ahar causes number of problem related to skin. Similarly, Ashtavid Parikshadi, eightfold examination, where pulse, urine, stool, tongue, speech, eye, etc. are discussed. Here, I would like to conclude within a minute that Ayurveda is not merely a system of medicine. Rather, it is a way of life. It is eco-friendly, cost-effective, and toxicity-free due to its holistic approach. So far as utility of preventive health checkup is concerned, understanding and application of tattva, Honorable Dr. Vashishji often use this word tattva. Understanding and application of the tattva of Trivid, Ashtavid, and Dashvid Pariksha, Pragya Parad, where you have to take care of your wisdom, covers the quantitative and qualitative assessment of body tissues, our dhatus, anthropometric evaluation, praman, pariksha, mental health analysis, etc. These are of immense utility for preventive health checkup. Further identifying the clinical disturbance at very initial stage by application of principles of Shatkriyakal and using organ specific rasayana is an important utility tool, not only for prevention and cure of disease, rather preservation and promotion of health as well. Integration between tradition and technology is the need of hour. In present scenario, ancient knowledge of Ayurveda is to be enriched with recent updated diagnostic tools to achieve the goal of healthy and happy life. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your patient hearing. That's all. This is already covered. Already covered.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your elaborate presentation. by considering the topic of preventive health checkup, one might have thought about the laboratory investigations which are going on yearly, like annual health checkups or like that. But you have elaborated the Ayurvedic point of view. Generally, we use the Dashavid Ashtavid Pariksha for examination of disease and examination of patient. But you have given the site to use these examinations for assessment of health. That is very insightful presentations. Thank you so much. Thank you for this elaborate presentation.